day in the life of Eddie Jordan, owner of the Jordan Formula One racing team. This is the heart of Formula One country. Not Monte Carlo or Monza, it's Oxford. No ordinary suburban house this, though. There are two doorbells for a start.
I'm going to press them both at the same time. Hi, how you
doing?
And a bloke to answer the door.
How you doing? I'm Adrian. Nice to see you. These are the troops.
Eddie, worryingly, doesn't seem to be expecting us.
Morning. How you doing? I'm Adrian. Nice to meet you. Sorry for the intrusion. Just carry on reading the paper. It's quite all right. Hi, Adrian. Nice to see you. How you doing? Nice to see you.
Eddie's story is a rags-to-riches affair. He had a go at race driving himself, but found he was better at raising money than driving, so he started his own team. It was a hand-to-mouth existence, but his wife Marie, who once represented Ireland at basketball, stuck by him. They have four children. Now he's rich, but his team, next to the likes of Ferrari, is very poor. Eddie's job is straightforward: to cut the deals, to raise the money, to keep the team in business.
You've got to be careful. I think the matriarch is coming. All hell breaks out when this happens.
I don't think I've ever met him.
Have you asked permission to come here? Because you could be in deep trouble.
Who did we ask? I don't think
there's only one person. In an Irish house, there's only one boss.
Oh, right.
And it's usually in a skirt. She's coming. Oh, she's made Adrian. This Maria.
How you doing? Nice to meet you. I've never met a lady basketball player.
Not before.
We're not going to be disturbed by you, I must tell you that. You know, we're not impressed just the fact that this is television.
nor should you be.
It's a wonderful family home, but there's no sign of the brood today.
What are they doing now, then?
It's always on her last year in Newcastle. She's doing business management, right. And she wants to go into sports management. Mickey is in Trinity, and she's doing French and Italian. And she has been working a little bit with Ferrari on the side, or in their clothing. And two boys are in Stowe. One hopes to go into the city, and the other one, no idea.
He's mummy's boy, and he thinks he's in for the few quid if she's got any left when I croak it. I'm going to make sure she's none left.
To spend it all would be no mean feat. He's worth around 90 million. But it hasn't always been this way.
But what did you think when you saw him swishing around in Monaco or something, and you were here surrounded by naughty and or breastfeeding kids or whatever?
Didn't have time to think about it.
Didn't you?
No.
Didn't have time to switch the telly on.
Monaco, the truth was, because we'd nowhere really to live in the season, in the very early days.
Yeah.
We lived in the caravan, which was hooked onto the back of the truck. So the first one, Zoe, lived with us for the first 2 years. And then the next one came, Mickey. But the first one, we were like nomads. And to this day, I believe it was the best time of my life. I was carefree, put the truck out, drove the truck with an Irish mechanic. And we had a Maori number two mechanic who couldn't sleep inside. He used to sleep underneath the truck. He was a complete lunatic. And it's just instances like this that remind you, why am I doing this thing? You know, the problem about motor racing is it's a drug. It's like you got in the main vein here, you know, and the needle, it's a, I don't know what, the pull or the draw or the attraction it had for me, but it was immense. Once it got into my blood system, I couldn't cope with not having it. It was a lure that almost everything else suffered as a result.
Since he's offered to show us round, seems a bit rude not to have a look.
Boys' room.
They must be so popular at school. Imagine having Eddie Jordan for a dad.
Yeah, but hang on, you say that.
Is there a downside?
There is a downside, because also in the same class as a son of Mick Jagger and a son of Richard Branson's son was there.
Oh,
as well.
So you're small potatoes,
actually. We're small fry, I'm afraid. When the kids would have a multitude of friends, as you can imagine, we lived very close to the schools. There could be 8-10 kids here most evenings. Yeah. It was a way of being able to come up here and still do my own thing. I could watch a football match or I could do my work. And we just didn't need the extra bedrooms anymore. And knocked three bedrooms into one.
That's a fantastic bathroom. You've had a shower this morning on demand, a bath now.
Well, this is the best shower in the world in there, because the power is outrageous. This is probably my favourite room in the house.
There's an eclectic mix of modern art here. I actually like this stuff, which is normally a bad sign.
Whose legs are they?
These are real legs, and I know the body that that is.
Yeah. Is the rest of her body just behind me?
No, just the arms, you see.
What's up to this poor woman here? Is she bored with motor racing?
No, well,
is
that why she's had to listen to me a bit too long, and I think she's finally caved in. They always do, you know.
Bored them into submission. And who are these ladies here? Are these are they anything to do with motor racing?
Well, this is a picture I had to be taken off the front. My mother, as I told you, this famous woman, she came here, she wasn't very impressed at all with these look-like ladies, which have stockings on and nothing else. Yeah. That's actually made out of just pure paper, coloured paper. It's not painted or anything. It's absolutely an amazing piece. Everyone who went to this school, called Sing Street, which is Sancta Maria, everyone, when they were being confirmed, took the name Mary. So you always know if there's somebody, Edward Patrick Mary Jordan, which is me, you'll always know most fellas who have Mary in their name went to Sing Street. It's a famous school for that sort of thing.
Is this where you get sent when you're naughty? Is this where money sends you?
This is when I really have a stressful day.
Yeah. And everybody, you come back here, everyone else is asleep.
Well, everyone, before I fight with everyone, the easiest thing is to come up here, spend 10 minutes, plug myself into whoever.
Yeah.
And just play to it.
Good morning, Oxford. Eddie Jordan is awake.
On paper, Jordan's not won very much. In 13 years, the team's only won 3 races, but that's a major achievement for a smaller team in the megabucks motor racing world. But Eddie's dream is to win the championship. No one gives him a prayer, but Eddie's used to getting what Eddie wants.
I have to win a championship, and at the moment, I'm not sure how many years I'm going to be around. Yeah. We need Michael Schumacher to retire. We need Ford and Jordan to build the most unbelievable car ever. And we need to get a seriously good budget and a seriously good bunch of sponsors together to make it happen.
What arguments do you use to persuade people to stick their company name on your car?
If you are a brand and you are trying to create a bigger, if you like, awareness factor of a brand from a global context, but sometimes it works domestically as well. And I'm just trying to figure out why he's doing that. And but anyway, so he's decided.
He's bigger than you.
You think should I have given in?
Yeah. I think, yeah.
So I was in full flow talking about my marketing expertise here, and he just stalled me.
He wasn't listening, was he? Sorry, go on.
So, there is no better, and this is nonsense aside, there is no better platform
to advertise
globally. I mean, if you want to get to Australia, you want to get to the Middle East, you want to get to Africa, you want to get to South America, some people, football is very much a tribal thing. So in other words, people in South America are not going to watch Tottenham and Southampton playing football.
I can get my name all over the world by sticking it on your car, but I'll say to you, well, I mean, you were 6th in the constructors last year, you're not winning many races, you know, I'll stick my name on Ferrari instead.
And so maybe you should. It depends. Jordan is a more rock and roll. It's slightly a little bit irreverent. It's vibrant. It's full of all of these.
So it's for younger brands.
So there's a younger, more. I think rock and roll. Everyone understands the thing. It's a rock and roll brand without being totally off the wall. It is extremely serious.
The team is paid for with the money Eddie extracts from business. But it's not easy getting sponsors for a team that hardly ever wins anything. To make matters worse, the business climate isn't great and interest in motor racing has waned. He's got his work cut out.
Even when things are down, and right at the moment,
whilst we have an outstandingly brilliant car, the environment, both economically and other situations, is as difficult. And so therefore, I feel in some ways that I'm failing the team because, as you rightly say, it's about how much money you can raise. And I haven't raised as much money as we should have.
I'm just going to say you can't park here, but actually you can park where you like.
I can park, that's my place there, but it looks a bit tricky and you've got a camera, so I don't want to go in there. I'm not that good. Someone else can park it.
Have you ever met that bloke, the world parking champion? Goes around in a Mini. They drive in there and he does three handbrake turns and then just suddenly magically is in there.
Well,
I wouldn't trust him in an F1 car, but he's quite good in his Mini, I must say.
Well, there's probably about a million of them in Ireland.
The HQ is a spanner's throw from Silverstone. Downstairs, the cars are designed and built, while upstairs, Eddie hatches multi-million pound plots to try to pay for it all.
You asked him for them to make sure they get tagged up. That was 1991. It won Car of the Year in our very first year. Never won it since, mind.
Yeah.
And it was just brought a new idea. It was very clean. Everything went, by clean, I mean aerodynamically clean.
Why is it not yellow then?
Because we were 7-Up at that stage.
Right.
We weren't always yellow. And may not always be yellow in the future.
Eddie needs more than £40 million to see his team through the season, but he's still short of most of that. For the very small amount it's worth, I've got a cunning plan.
Do you know who've got... I did a documentary about Chanel, who've got pots of money and never do sports sponsorship. You know, sooner or later, somebody's going to tap into them. And I just think it's interesting what you said about you've got a younger, funkier brand. The documentary was about their efforts to make their brand younger. Because Chanel No. 5, your granny's got it, and they're desperate to make the brand younger. And I just wonder whether it's worth tapping them up at some stage, because sooner or later they'll do sports sponsorship, but they've never done any yet.
I don't know where I'd start with Chanel, but I'd try and first start somewhere. I might say, OK, well, we need a brand that needs a fair level of the colour yellow, younger, more youthful, more vibrant.
How much sponsorship money have you got to find before the season starts?
Historically, I would be looking for about $75 million. It's hard to see how I'm going to achieve that this year.
What have you got so far of that $75
million? Between the TV and various other sponsors, I've got about 42 at this moment in time, which is a big shortfall.
So what do you like doing a deal? If you had a car, just say a saloon car or something you're going to sell me, your Range Rover, you're going to sell it and I wanted to buy, who'd win the deal? You'd win the deal. I could never beat you down.
No, you'd win every time. I'm a soft touch. Look at me. I'm not like Ron Dennis. He is the master. I'm the poor relation.
Hang on, you got $25 million or $25 million out of Deutsche Post, out of some Germans. That's not bad going.
I said at least.
At least.
No, but listen, they got £100 million worth of value from that. No,
Guinness would have been great. You could have been all black and then just a white bit on the tail fin.
The cream on the top.
Yeah.
You sound as if you were doing an ad for Guinness. You're doing the voiceover for the Guinness ad.
No.
Can't imagine.
When's the last Brummy you heard on a Guinness advert? Or Murphy's even, or something like that. But it'd look good on the car, wouldn't it?
Getting a word in.
We'll see you later.
Okay. Can I unplug this thing?
Today's first meeting is with the head of Ford Motorsport Europe. Though Jordan's an independent team, Ford supplies the engines. And they want to discuss their big and little ends without contributions from me.
We're in the canteen at... what is it? Jordan? It's the home of Jordan, I think. It's the factory. Your man's upstairs in a meeting with Martin Whitaker, who's head of motorsport at Ford. He's unplugged his microphone, so we can't hear him. Seems like a nice guy, though, doesn't he?
He was quite nice this morning, wasn't he? His wife was pretty nice.
I'm not in it again.
Meeting over, and there's no sign of Eddie's victim.
What have you done with Martin? You finished him off?
He's dead.
Is he? He's gone.
He's afraid to show his face.
You rubbed him out.
Nicked all his money. He's wounded.
Does everybody walk out of this building with less money in their wallet than when they walked
in? No, this is just a myth. Everyone, no, what I'm saying is they go out with bigger value.
Yeah.
You've confused the story. You don't
money
want to be telling
value.
This stuff,
yeah, huh? Yeah. Money and value are different things.
Money is just a horrible word, isn't it? Value and value, presentation. Right. Philip, are you coming with us?
Yeah. It's off to the track for the first ever road test of the new car.
Ian Phillips is commercial director of Jordan Grand Prix, so the lack of money, will you stop slagging me off for not actually finding him? Will you have a go at him? Because he's completely useless.
Yeah.
I employed him in 1989. He had meningitis then. I was told he'd only last a year, so I thought, well, I could get as much as I could out of him for the year.
Yeah.
But he's still around and he's probably healthier, and now he keeps going through marriages and new children. He's about to be a dad again, so I don't know what's in his water, but obviously I need to get some of it. I think we're getting the VIP treatment. I don't know whether it's because we've got a camera or whether I paid the bill to hire the circuit.
No, we haven't paid.
So how does it work?
How does it work now? Can you come on this circuit whenever you want? Or you pay every time you want
to
drive
it? Well, we won't go into paying because Silverstone and Jordan, we give them show cars and we allow them to do things. Ian, do you have any idea where we are?
Oh, actually, try going right here. I think we might have needed to go around the ring road.
So, just get where we are at the moment. You haven't got a major sponsor, or is Benson Hedges the major sponsor?
We will tell you in about an hour's time. Yeah. They're coming to us to start talking about this year's season.
Right.
Now,
so how much money you get off them is an imponderable at this stage.
No, I think it's pretty identified.
Yeah.
It's how we get it up from where we is.
Right.
You know, there is difference.
You need to get it a bit higher.
So, does Irvine play a role in it? Does a British driver play in a role? Who's going to pay for what? How do we structure that?
Yeah.
I think I brought you the wrong way, and we're having a nice little detour around.
Can we not get them on?
Steady, Eddie. They're not going to start without you.
I think I'm going to get a bollocking from Sid. You are the first TV crew ever to have seen this Jordan car.
I'm not big on motor racing, but it's difficult not to be impressed by the vast amount of expertise, time and money that's brought the team to this moment. This is the shakedown, but after countless man hours building the car, they find out if the thing actually works. I'd be terrified, but Eddie's more worried about Marie finding out what he's doing to his arteries.
Don't let on that I'm having chocolate during the day. The wife will kill me. A, the cholesterol, and B, the waistline.
Have you got high cholesterol?
Yeah. I had wicked. I don't think there's anyone in the world with higher cholesterol than me.
Really?
Honestly, I don't know why that is. I had 9 point something, and when I told people, they didn't believe me. So, Professor Watkins,
he's a Formula One doctor.
Yeah, he said you need a right good glass of red wine every night, and a few other things that we shouldn't be talking about. And our biggest success to date is that the last test I was down to 3.9. But it's amazing, you know, in years gone by you've forgotten about it, and I might be brown bread by now if I hadn't sorted it out.
So you pay all these people, you've got to employ all these people, they're all working for you. It's a hell of a responsibility really, isn't it?
This is a fraction of the people. But as I said to you, it's quite, I think it's a revealing day. First day is an experience. Anyone who wants time to come and see the car for the very first time, because it's an imprimatur, isn't it? It actually sets the tone for the season as to whether they think it's going to be good or bad.
How much do you understand of what's going on? I mean, they're all looking at those computer screens over there. Do you understand what they're doing?
I mean, I'm not a trained engineer, and I want to be, or I'm not a boffin in terms of IT or any of the information you can draw, but I could get a red form.
One of Eddie's two drivers this season is a friendly little Italian chap, Giancarlo Fisichella. The other driver is yet to be appointed, and the season's only 8 weeks away. So for the time being, it's all on the fella in the woolly hat. No wonder Eddie's so fond of him.
He is 30 today.
Hi, happy birthday.
Thank you.
Happy birthday. I'm from BBC. Just following the boss around.
He's a Roma fan.
I know, I'm ready.
The machine which Giancarlo will trust to take him round the world circuits at terrifying speeds is minutes from rolling for the first time. But almost important as the car itself is the rest of the fleet.
This, what you see here in terms of all of, nothing would be in these because they'd be locked at the moment. Everything would be transferred back into the factory. So this is the first day out. And that tail goes back, and this takes one car on top. and takes two or three cars along here. That's why you can fit them all, and all the spare parts are in the belly lockers. And it's a full, so in other words, we're in the middle of a field here in Silverstone, so all of the power and the generation, we generate our own power, so all of the stuff to run the computers comes from big compressors and generators that are built in all the
bottoms. How'd you get this to Australia then?
Oh no, these are only for Europe. In Australia, we have a flyaway pack, which again, as a result, we've been able to reduce the costs of our travel, mainly with DHL and with Deutsche Post. They told us and showed us how to pack things into their pallets, which has saved us a lot of money and ease of travel. So we don't need these trucks to go there.
So what's the cost of getting the team, say, to Australia?
You can take Australia about being about £4 million all up, if you think about the freight, all of the people. But then if you're, I'm including the cost of the engines, the cost of running the cars. So if you were to take all of that out, basically it costs about, just on the engine alone, costs near enough $1 million, certainly over $1 million.
That's for every Grand Prix?
Yes.
It's a long season. Eddie and this travelling circus will see 16 Grand Prix in 5 continents between March and October.
And how much time do you have to spend away at that time? Do you get...
Hardly come back at all. I try and maybe, if I am. Between Malaysia and Brazil, because you've got to come back this way, I'd get that weekend at home.
And how's Marie with all that? She...
Something that's never really been said. Our summer holiday is always at Christmas time when I know I can be there, whereas in the summer, every 2 weeks I have a Grand Prix, so it's very hard to plan things.
What about when the kids were very small?
I probably feel I lost out, certainly with Zoe, the eldest girl, I probably lost out 10 years with her, which is always a hard thing to justify.
But when she was 15 and you were having an argument, as all fathers have with 15-year-old girls, did you ever get the, well, you know, you were in Malaysia, what did you care?
No, never allowed that. The main problems I had with Zoe was trying to stay in the house. She was always a great one for nightlife, and particularly summertime when I expected she was going to bed at 11 and 12 o'clock at night, I used to get suspicious, and it wasn't until afterwards Marie told me she used to get out the window, and I couldn't understand why she would never be up in the morning. So I followed her a couple of times, much to her great annoyance, and I frog marched her more or less at about 4:30 a.m. back into the car down in Spain, so as to get, what was she doing? And she really, I think she was more upset because that she'd been shown up in front of our friends, but I'd had it by then.
But she's never thrown at you the fact that you were away and...
No, they always see, but they see that as work.
Yeah.
Mind you, they never say, well, how was work today? They just say, how was the race? Because they'd watch it on the TV and they'd know my... how I would be on the Monday when I'd return, whether I would be happy with the result or not happy, so they'd know whether to avoid me or to be around.
I'm getting nervous now. It's just got it out.
Huh?
Fantastic, all that teamwork and everything.
Do you know there's none of them ever talking to each other?
Really?
They know what they're doing.
As if I want to hug that poor little boy. He's only a little Italian guy. But I mean, he's risking his life for himself and for you, I suppose, isn't he? Does that...
No, I don't think they ever think like that.
But do you think like that?
No.
So you don't worry for the kids then?
When they have a huge accident and there's no movement in the car, there's a moment I say to myself, Jesus, I hope he's safe. And that's the only thing you think about. And then when he gets out of it, you say, that bastard has destroyed my car. He's cost me a fortune.
How's that sound to you? Promising?
Well, you know, your first ever time, can you imagine all of the bits that are made, manufactured and put together, thousands of parts, and it runs for the first time up and down and there's no apparent problem, but of course there will be problems to sort out, but the fact that it works first time is it's the first tick in the box.
Yeah.
You say, well, it works. Now we can only make it better.
So what happens now then? He goes back in, they tinker around,
no,
and he goes
they
again.
They will word everything up to the data. Yeah. They will check all of the things to see what is working, what's not working, and then analyze that journey. Yeah. Now it becomes tedious. It's just gradually going through all
But will
the
he memory. Go out again?
Oh yeah, 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 all day. And you'll be frozen here, and I'm leaving here now that I've actually seen it run.
I saw you kissing the boss earlier on, which is always nice to see. Do you kiss all your bosses, or is it just because you like Eddie the best?
No. Just eat Eddie. I got a good friendship with him. He's a nice guy. And I worked already in 97 with them, so it's been a... I remember it's been a good time, and I got still a good friendship with the Jordan team, and especially with Eddie.
How does he compare to other bosses, other Formula One bosses? Is he different?
Is he different? Completely different. You know
him. Well, actually, I don't know him. I mean, you know him better than me.
The craziest boss on Formula One team, but it's nice. And I think we need in Formula One people like him.
Right, well, I hope you're still kissing him at the end of this season. That's the main thing.
In the podium, maybe.
Yeah. You look terribly vulnerable in that car. I worry about you a little bit. You look sort of stuck. Be careful out there.
Yeah, don't worry.
Over the last 13 years or so, this, beyond any doubt, for me, is the most exciting moment. Always the first time you see your car run for the first time. But I've never been so enthusiastic like all of the people from the very bottom to the very top about this particular car, because our whole future revolves in the success of this. But I think we just need one special little thing, because not often you are 30, and our driver Giancarlo, who is going to be the hope and our savior of Jordan Grand Prix. Can we have a round of applause and a little cake? Woo! On Saturday night, I had no idea, but I had to make a presentation. All of the drivers in the last number of years were asked on a poll to pick the driver that they felt was the quickest, the fairest, the most mannerly, and the best presented driver as a sportsman and everything else. And it was absolutely a magic favor for me to be able to present to Giancarlo, the driver's driver. So I think that is well worth it.
But to keep Giancarlo and the rest of the team smiling and in work, a serious amount of money still needs to be raised before the season starts. Today, Benson and Hedges are here to discuss sponsorship. Eddie's right-hand man is waiting outside. He's braced for a punishing meeting.
I normally come out with bruised ankles. He always makes sure that he sits next to me, and I get kicked to kingdom come, to be honest. But no, we talk about it loosely before we go. We've got a rough idea. There's a strategy in place, but the script tends to be made up as we go along.
So Eddie leaves for his meeting. Cutting a deal with Eddie is slightly different to cutting a deal with anyone else. Just ask Martin Whitaker of Ford.
I suppose the only real difference is that probably people who negotiate with him perhaps have a bit of fun at the same time. It's a rather odd way of looking at it, but at least you know you've had a negotiation with Eddie, and you probably come out smiling about it afterwards.
Yeah. I've seen him described as somebody who you can he'll shake your hand and tell you to F off at the same time.
Yeah, well, his language is pretty rich, there's no doubt about that.
Yeah.
But no, the crucial thing about any deal with Eddie is that you've got to take him on at his own game. You've got to understand that he's going to be looking for the best deal. But most importantly, the spirit and the charisma that is behind this team comes from that man, and ultimately that's what's going to see them through, and hopefully this car will do the business on the track for them.
I wonder if he gets a better deal because he's likeable, because people know he's important to the industry as a whole, and if you end up shafting Eddie Jordan and the whole thing falls down, then Formula One will be the poorer for it.
Well, I think there's an element to that, because you're absolutely right, and it's worth remembering, of course, he's one of the few private individuals effectively left in the business. I mean, this is a manufacturer dominated sport, and he's one of the individuals in it. So yes, I mean, he is important to the sport.
It's now 3 hours since Eddie left with the with his finance man and the blokes from Benson Hedges.
the most important meeting of the year, I think, because at the moment Benson Hedges are committed to giving them no money for the season. If that happens, if that stays like that, and that, as I understand it, the team goes bust. So they're in negotiations to get as much money out of them as possible in sponsorship. And he's just vanished. We thought he was meeting in his room up there, but he's not. He's just gone. Perhaps this is the end. They've all fallen out. They haven't done the deal, and that's the end of that.
But eventually there are signs of movement, and we're summoned in to assess the damage.
How did it go as far as you could say? Did he keep kicking you under the table?
I had to call for first aid after about an hour and a half. In the first 10 minutes, he actually had the toe of his shoe caught in my trouser leg.
What were you kicking him for? What was he doing?
Because he was giving the crown jewels away. He wanted to give them everything.
And I was trying to stop him from giving the crown jewels away.
But they got the deal then. So they've gone away to think about the price, as I understand it.
I think they've gone away to think about spending the most amount of money they possibly can.
Sure, there might be more attractive deals elsewhere, but they see in Jordan a good partner. Through good and bad times, we've always tried and been successful in giving them good value for money. They trust us also, which is a vital thing in any relationship like that. After 7 years, they know what we're likely to do and they know what I'm always likely to get.
But in business, you only find loyalty in the dictionary, don't you?
No.
If they can get more publicity for fewer bucks, if you, as you said, there's a better deal elsewhere.
Yeah, but you
there
see,
must be a temptation for
that probably in a clean, very straightforward, cold type of a business arrangement. That for that, here you have to get the things. It's the brochures, it's the magazines, it's the colour, the application of the things, it's the image that's going forward. There's so many things you would never be able to put a price on that are addendums to the value.
How did the meeting go then? So you've given them a price and they've got to come back and
say, they always had a price, and there was that parameter was set. It was what they got for that price. Yeah. And you know, there's no doubt that they would like Eddie Irvine for that included in it. They would like a whole lot of other, if you like, on a shopping list of requirements that they'd
like. A British driver, just to be clear, would make their spend.
A British driver would be, because there's more they can do with it. But if there was a British driver, their first choice would be Eddie Irvine. And they believe...
What do you think about that? Do you fancy that?
I have no problem either way. I think Eddie Irvine, in many respects, he has a lot of experience. In our particular position, this new engine we've got, which is the Ford, he has worked with it last year, so there would be an initial big advantage in terms of things like magazines, boy magazines, girl, men magazines, and other papers. Eddie Irvine sells copy, and therefore but not just that, he is experienced, he's able to bring the car home, he's very reliable, he always gets points.
Giancarlo's off.
Where are you going?
Home. Bye-bye.
Drive carefully.
He's got a day off because the car didn't work. Call me.
Did it conk out this afternoon then?
No, they did some things they wanted to do. All today was about was to get in to run.
So with this agent, who's more desperate? Is it you to get Irvine, or is it Irvine's agent to get Irvine the drive? That's what I don't quite.
Well, on the basis of the law of diminishing returns, there's plenty of drivers.
Does he want Payne to drive for you?
Well, on the basis that he got 10 million last year, he probably doesn't want it on his CV that Jordan extracted money, because then it only adds to your story, doesn't it? Because you think I take money from everybody, but it's actually a fallacy. It doesn't work out that way. Yeah. But Irvine wouldn't want it to be said that Eddie Jordan took money from him.
What are racing drivers like as a breed? Do you like them?
Extraordinarily selfish.
Yeah.
Only ever think about themselves.
Yeah.
Totally arrogant. More arrogant they are, the better they are. Having said that, I think Fisichella is one of the exceptions. And generally, totally self-centered and only ever think about what's in life for them. But if they weren't like that, they'd be no good. So I'm not being critical of them. I'm saying that is the breed of any major world-class athlete, that they have to be like that.
Eddie is everyone's friend, but I wouldn't like to cross him. He tours his works with the air of a popular headmaster popping into an A-level engineering class.
And they have no idea we were coming down here. I've had permission, lads, don't worry.
I've never seen this man in long trousers in my life.
Haven't you?
He's only been here about 7 years.
He's got nice legs. Can we have a close-up on them?
For
extra.
But what he does do is make nice gearboxes. And he is responsible for this particular one. He put the crown wheel in. It's most of it. Like, has something to get. And the token shamrock, because that is our little emblem.
He even crunch the gears or something. You curse at the telly.
No, he gets his P45.
Yeah, just...
I help but notice this is generally a very male environment. There's very, very, very few women. I'm seeing one. There's a woman answering the phone, and there's a woman PR person. There's not an engineer though. Well, the marketing.
There is a girl engineer, and we've always had an open policy about that, because actually I prefer girls that are cheaper, more reliable, and better looking. It's stronger than aluminium.
Yeah.
And yet a fraction of the weight. Talk about weight.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
That's astonishing,
yeah. That's the engine cover.
But how robust can it be, though? That's the...
Well, it's material first, so it's never going to destroy itself. What happens is the resins may crack on its impact, but this is what gives it its absolutely fantastic safety record with drivers. Because when they hit something, in the old days when I was driving, the reason why I've broken my leg so many times was that when you're going around a corner and the front suspension breaks, you hit the wall like that.
Yeah.
In the aluminium cars, the car used to crash in on top of you.
Yeah.
With this, you just bounce off it. You might break everything, but it'll bounce. It won't cave in on top of you. It can only explode. It can't implode.
So it's got a lot safer.
See, so there's his oven. You want to go in?
What's he cooking himself for? Why does it go all the way around? That's just for space reasons.
And the reason is, there is a rule which says the top of the chassis has to, so you don't want it filled in there.
Yeah,
because when the rule is the maximum height from the top to the thing, and so in other words, to cut it away.
And how sensitive.
And the reason for that being so low is because the driver's legs are so close, you don't want it in a circle because it can catch them.
So just a tiny little twitch on that.
And then the movement is like that.
But a tiny little twitch on that sends the car around. I'm amazed you've got so much on site, because I mean the capital outlay, the cost of buying this machinery in, you must have done the sums, but it would strike me as being a load cheaper to send it to, I don't know, a foundry in Birmingham or whatever it needed to get it done there.
But if you sent it up to your lot in Birmingham, you might never get it back.
Running a race team seems to me hugely complicated and very expensive. How much easier to make your money staging the races instead? How much easier to be the head of Formula One, Bernie Eccleston?
He doesn't have any of these worries, does he? Doesn't
you need a pass from him, otherwise you wouldn't say things like that.
Well, it's a point though, isn't it? He doesn't have R&D, he doesn't have wind tunnels.
Because he is the one who has the brains. He did have, and then he realised, here, I don't want to be a mug all my life. Leave that to the Jordans and the Dennises and the Frank Williamses of this world. I'd rather be in there cashing in the loot and putting the promotional aspect together, which is... I'm just going through the motions to get to there for my next job, you know?
Yeah. He's not having as much fun as you, though, is he? Or is he?
I'm not sure he has the same amount of pain either, somehow or another. But
what's he like? Did you get on with it?
Perfect. He's actually a real proper fella. It takes you a while. He is intimidating, no doubt about it. I wouldn't want to be coming into it again. It's taken me 10 years to be brave with him, but I'm brave with him now.
As well as being short of cash, Eddie's still short of a driver. Eddie Irvine, one of Formula One's more glamorous stars, is a possibility, and his agent has come in for talks. Like most things in Formula One, though, it's not as simple as it could be.
To keep Eddie in a seat, normally in a normal situation, Irvine would command quite a respectable salary. Now, it could be that his agent in there has a number of other sponsors that he can actually get and put on our car and use that as collateral effort to negotiate Eddie's price. In other words, here's some money to the team and I will take responsibility to pay for Irvine. Now, if he does something on the basis of like that, then of course we would have to consider the Irvine, which would be fine.
Right.
Does that make sense?
But basically you've got, it comes down to the fact that...
We need money for the second seat.
Yeah, but the ball's in your court. If you've got, I mean, it's a big thing, a seat in a Formula One car.
Absolutely.
You've got an empty seat. So in the papers, all the paper coverage I've read is they're desperate to fill the seat. But in fact, it's the other way around. There must
we're not going to tell that, are we?
Yeah.
In other words, if Irvine's agent says Company X will sponsor Jordan for £20 million if, and only if, Irvine gets the drive, then Irvine might well get the drive.
So you want Eddie Irvine to come here?
No, they want Eddie Irvine.
Oh,
this
sorry.
Is...
Sorry, we've got a little confusion here. Sorry, Alliance Craft. I don't think that's quite the right story.
Right.
Hang on a second. What are you doing here?
You called me. I don't know.
No, you said you wanted to take me for dinner.
But I wouldn't be in your position because you've got one of the world's best negotiators. No. There's only one seat left.
You don't want to be in my position. I give you 10, 15 reasons you want to be in my position.
All right.
Do you want the telephone numbers?
All right.
That's
fine. But I don't see how you can possibly negotiate.
Yeah.
There's one seat left. So you say, so what would you say? You can either take it or leave it.
Absolutely. But in a nice way.
Right.
Like
Eddie's press woman is getting a bit restless, and so is Eddie. I don't know how to break this to myself, but I think he's suddenly had enough of me.
Huh?
After this, they'll leave you to it for a bit.
Yeah, I just need to have about four or five really important calls.
So what time will you be out of here then?
Are you coming home with me? I think you
are. I'm coming, mate. You can't be with me yet. Not until you go.
She said, you've lumbered me with this lot, haven't you? What did I ever agree to do this for? You tried to tell me you'd be good for my image. I think we've destroyed my image.
So what do you do? What do you do for him? What's your job description?
Press officer.
Right. You spend a lot of time running around looking quite harassed. Some jiggling, sometimes quite violently on the spot. Is that what you do most days?
That's what it's like at race weekends, mostly. In the factory, it's like that if Eddie has agreed to spend some time doing media interviews. But most of the time, I'm answering the phone to all the people who want to talk to him. And everybody wants a piece of Eddie. So it's just trying to juggle it and cajole him into spending half an hour or so each week to do some media interviews. So you've had a whole day with him.
Right.
So when I'm jigging up and down, it's because he's been... He loves talking to... media, so I've got to try and
force him to do other things.
Yeah, getting back to doing other things.
But you should go and work for another team boss who never wants to talk to the media. Then you got an easy press officer's job, then, haven't you? You could just say no. That's the easiest answer to give.
I've got nothing to do. Yeah, no. It is a juggling act because we know at Jordan that our success with sponsors and fans is based on how open we are. And that we'll invite people in and you can bring your camera around or you can talk to Eddie for half an hour at home or whatever. Whereas lots of teams wouldn't do that. And so it's always a juggling act to try and fit that around Eddie's diary to make
sure. Does he ever say the wrong thing?
Every time he opens his mouth. Doesn't say the wrong thing. Yeah. He says what he's thinking, but for a PR person, you might want him to say something a bit more politically correct, but you always get the real deal with Eddie. Eddie doesn't do PR speak, really.
Right. Okay. Do you feel protective towards him?
Yes, I do.
Because he puts his head above the parapet so often, it'd be shame if somebody started shooting at him, wouldn't it?
Well, people do often take a pop at him because he puts himself in the public eye and says what he thinks. So a lot of the time, he's open to criticism, and people take the opportunity. Sometimes it's fair and sometimes I think it's not fair. And when it isn't, we always try and correct it. You can't always do that, though.
Where is he? Where's the man asking all these stupid questions? He's gone off to ask.
Barry, do you think we can see him again together?
Eddie's a patron of CLIC, cancer and leukemia in childhood. Tonight is a celebration of everyone's hard work, but before he can start enjoying himself, I just need to test his tolerance of me one more time.
We'll get out of your way. Can I have a last word with you, and then we'll get going?
Do you have to?
We'll be out of here then. I've got a few questions in my little red book left to ask you.
Not in here.
No, I'll just take you out there.
Oh, they're very serious questions.
Yeah, no.
Do I really need to do this?
Let's spend the day. This is when I ask the awkward questions, because I can't get slung out of the house at 7 in the morning. So
come on, hurry up.
Have a good night. Thanks very much. Nice to meet you. Hope it goes well.
All things taken together, has this been a good day then? Apart from the fact that you've had me harassing you all day.
I think I've done a fair amount. You know, I always have to assess every day, do I feel, because I have this notion that I could be lazy if I was allowed myself. And I said, did I have a proactive day? And I have, yeah. I've run around the place and I've been busy and I've been thinking about things, and there's a couple of little things that came off. I was very happy with the Benson and Hedges thing, because Ian and I came up with something. That's why I was kicking his ankle off to shut up, because I was, something had just come into my head that I thought was crucial for what they wanted to do.
So you're confident that deal will come?
No, I'm not confident, because you never can be confident, because as soon as you think the deal is done, there's always something that happens.
So you're not a counter of chickens there?
No. Has to be in the bank before you start counting. The one thing you mentioned about a great salesman, am I a clincher? I think I am. I am able to convince someone to take money from that pocket and put it in this pocket, effectively speaking, bank account, in terms of, I think I can close deals.
Have you made many enemies along the way? Can you get very far without making enemies in this business?
It would be a problem for me if I did make too many enemies. Because I need to be loved. I'm telling you my innermost secrets now. I'm a person who lives on the edge and says some strange things, but I also need to know that the people are 100% behind me. It's half my motivation, therefore I can't let them down, whether it be staff or friends or whatever, family. It has to be, I have to know either it's love or respect, and on that basis, that's how I exist.
All right. So
the enemies, I would hope they're fairly few and far between.
When have you been most peed off with the whole thing? When have you been most annoyed?
Only when the car is bad. I'm buzzing.
Yeah.
I know I'm going to make no money this year. I know I'm not going to be able to pay myself, because other things need to be done. But I don't need to pay myself. I've made some money. I'm not a problem about that. And I'm happy. And the reason I'm happy is because I know I'm going to have a really good season with this car.
Self-doubt is not in Eddie Jordan's psyche. He's a salesman. And today, like most days, he's been selling himself and the maverick rock and roll ideals of Jordan Motor Racing. Companies pay millions to have their names on his cars, all because they want to feel part of the Jordan experience. He's totally charming, but never lets you forget he's not to be trifled with. He's well aware of his celebrity status. He reminded us more than once just how lucky we were to have so much of his time and how grateful we should be for it. He's a bit of a show-off, but motor racing is a showing-off kind of business. His enthusiasm is infectious, and he doesn't know when he's beaten, usually.
We've been with you 13, 14 hours now. Is that enough? Should we leave you in peace now?
I think if you haven't got enough in this, I'm sorry, I'm finished, because you've worn me out.
All right, we'll let you get on. Listen,
it's been a real pleasure.
It's been great talking to you.
I'm going to kill. I've just sacked the girl, the press officer, who told me I should do this.
Yeah.
Because I see no logic as to why I did it in the first place.
I'm all right in small doses, but you've had a big dose.
Do you think?
Yeah.
Actually, I didn't think you were too bad. I think we banished you to the car more often. You're very well behaved.
You literally didn't tow me behind your new car, dragging me along the floor. That would have been a kick in the teeth.
Hey, the new car. I forgot about that. Anyway, rock and roll. We can turn all that off now. Yeah. We're finished.